So he had this recovery that was totally against all probability. And in medicine, we say, oh, it was an outlier, and we're just grateful that it happened, even if we don't understand it. But I couldn't ignore the fact that this had occurred in response to his wife's prayer.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast,
helping you and your family thrive in Christ.
Well, today we are going to talk about suffering. It's not a light subject. It's probably not a subject that you want to talk about in our modern culture. We want happy, joyful, kind of superficial discussions. Mm-hmm. But it is important to understand that suffering is a part of this life, that God is with us in that. And sometimes it doesn't feel that way. And we have a wonderful guest who is going to walk us through her journey of doubt and reaffirmation in her faith. And I think it will carry a lot of weight for you. Mm. You know, Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." He also told his followers that he would never leave us or forsake us. But I know for some of you listening and viewing right now, you're going, I used to think that, but I'm not sure where I'm at today. This program is going to be for you.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Kathryn Butler joins us. She was trained in surgery and critical care at Massachusetts General Hospital and Harvard Medical School. And she now writes for DesiringGod.org and the Gospel Coalition about topics like faith and medicine and shepherding kids in the gospel. Katie has written a terrific book. It's called Glimmers of Grace, A Doctor's Reflections on Faith, Suffering, and the Goodness of God. Look for your copy of that book on our website. The details are in the show notes.
Kathryn, welcome back to Focus.
Thank you so much, Jim and John. It's a joy to be here.
And I know you go by Katie. It's just hard to talk to a doctor like that.
I'm
Katie.
Sorry. I feel like I'm in trouble when I'm called Kathryn.
Yeah, Kathryn, step over here.
Exactly.
As you got into the medical field, what was your faith experience like? I mean, sometimes you could be so heavy into science that you can forget about God, that it seems like it's all right here, materialistic.
Yeah. Well, my journey actually to being a believer was through my work. And God brought me to a place that was very, very low through witnessing the suffering that my patients were enduring. Mm. But he also brought me to himself through the suffering that I then endured as a result. And that's the whole impetus, actually, for me writing this book, is to try to help people who are suffering through illness be able to see God's goodness.
Well, I so appreciate that, because you were, I would use the word, unnaturally inundated with suffering as a doctor. Yeah. It's almost like you saw too much of it.
Yeah, and I did not have any kind of bedrock of strong faith. I didn't grow up in the church. Christmas and Santa Claus were center stage for me in terms of Christianity. I had no concept of the gospel, never read the Bible. I believed in God and I would pray, but I didn't know to whom. And I certainly didn't have any sense of the fact that I was a sinner who needed to be saved. I thought that being a Christian meant being a good person, which is clearly not the case. And then it was one night in the emergency room about halfway through my surgical training where I came face to face with suffering in a very raw and deep way.
What happened?
I had this position halfway through my residency where I worked in the emergency room for 24 hours and I go home for 24 hours back and forth. And during that 24-hour period, it was our job to manage everything surgical that came into the ER. So things as mundane as having a little laceration on your hand to ruptured aortic aneurysms. It was my job to figure out what to do and stabilize the patient so that the attending physicians could take care of them. And I loved it because I loved the opportunity to come alongside people when they were most vulnerable and in most need of help. That to me was incredibly gratifying. Even though I wasn't a believer yet, there was something, a spirit of service that really resonated.
Yeah.
However, there was one night where I had three young men who came in that I couldn't save. And it really confronted me with the problem of evil. So I had one 20 or 22-year-old gentleman who came in after having been assaulted in his bed with a baseball bat. His wife died during the assault. His four-year-old son witnessed everything. Mm-hmm. And he came in hemorrhaging into his brain, bleeding into his brain. And he was on the verge of dying. And so I was scrambling to try to stabilize him so that the neurosurgeons could take him to the operating room. And all I could think about in the back of my mind as I'm trying to focus on placing a central line, which is a big line that goes into the veins underneath your collarbone, was, what is this little boy gonna do How is he going to cope? What kind of life is he going to have after he just witnessed his parents be murdered in front of him? And as I was still reeling from that, my pager went off again. Another 15-year-old shot in the head this time. And when he came in, his pupils were fixed and dilated because he was brain dead.
Yeah.
There was nothing that we could do. And so I said, what can I do in this scenario? What could I possibly do to help? And the only thing I could think of was, let me clean him up so that when the family comes in, they see some semblance of the boy that they love. Mm-hmm. And so I started to clean up the wound and to stitch it closed. And some well-meaning but unknowing staff member brought his mom into the room while I was working.
Oh.
And so she came in and she sees her beautiful boy with blood around his head and his brain matter on my hands, and she just started howling and crumpled to the ground in grief. And I just tugged off my gloves and threw them away and ran from the room and hid in the bathroom for a little while to cry, but then had to work another 12 hours.
Yeah.
And the whole time when I was on my shift, I just kept thinking, I didn't know much about God, but how could a God, if he was good, which is what I had always assumed, allow this kind of thing to happen? Because all the people who perpetrated these assaults had looked at these kids and seen no worth. And I thought, how could God allow this kind of suffering for families? And how could he allow this kind of evil? And the grief was so profound that the next morning, even though I should have gone home since I was up for 30 hours, I felt like something vital had just been torn from me.
Huh.
And I drove 100 miles into the Berkshire Mountains to try to connect with something good and something true.
Something calm.
Exactly. And just, yeah. And it was one of those beautiful October days in New England. I don't know if you've ever witnessed them, where it just, I was driving through the mountains and it was like the trees were lit afire. And I pulled onto a bridge over the Connecticut River and the bridge was a mirror for the sky. It was just like God's artistry was all around me. Like the fingerprints of the fact that he's a creator and he's good were all around me. But I had no basis to understand any of it because I'd never read the Bible.
Yeah.
And so I held onto the railing and tried to pray. But not having scripture in my heart, I had no words. And I decided I couldn't pray because he didn't exist. Mm. And so I walked away from that bridge, convinced there was no God. And then for the next year, was agnostic. And in the setting of that agnosticism, had the worst depressive episode of my life. Because if there's no God, what's the purpose to anything?
Right.
What hope do we have? And to the point where I kept repeatedly imagining going back to that bridge and just throwing myself over.
Yeah.
And the only thing that stayed me from doing that by God's kindness was my husband. That I had a husband who loved me and I knew he'd be heartbroken.
Kate, I mean, this is really despair.
It was.
I mean, you're
it
in
was.
A point of deep despair.
I was.
Because and in that, the elements of that had to be you couldn't do enough.
Right.
I mean,
exactly.
Here you are given to saving life.
Exactly. And you realize that we are finite and fallen.
Yeah.
It's what we know now as Christians, that we're limited and we're fallen in sin and only God can truly save. And but I didn't have any framework to understand.
Yeah.
That.
And we're going to unfold this over the next few minutes. But you also had another patient, I think his name's David, who often struggled with remaining in faith.
Yes.
And you had some great discussions with him. What did he say and how did you relate to the difficulty of understanding the goodness of God together?
Yeah. So, I mean, my situation was I didn't have an understanding of the Bible, but David was a disciple of Christ through and through.
And he's a patient.
He was a patient. He was my dear friend. So
it's rare for a patient to teach a doctor something.
No, he taught me more about suffering and faith in the hospital setting than any of my actual patients that I cared for. This was just a dear friend whom I happened to walk alongside toward the end of his life through illness.
Wow.
And his story, his whole life was an overflow of gratitude for Christ.
Huh. Even in his circumstances. Yes,
but the only thing that ever tested those circumstances was his trial in the hospital.
Wow.
His background was that he actually struggled with drug abuse for many years and spent 10 years homeless on the streets of New York, just looking for the next high. Tried to commit suicide once, and he sees it as God's grace toward him. A good Samaritan saw what he tried to do, and in his words, treated him like the image bearer he was, packed with potential and deserving of love, is what he would always say, and intervened and spoke to him softly and got him to the ER. And after that point, David turned things around by God's grace.
Wow.
He devoted himself to Christ, and then he lived his life constantly talking about God's goodness. You know, he was just an overflow of love for Christ.
Made an impression on you,
yes,
obviously.
Yes. And so it was all the more upsetting to me when then he started to go into the end stages of emphysema to see his faith start to become shaky. The things that he loved in terms of teaching Sunday school and running a small group and tending a memorial garden for HIV patients crumbled away because he became tethered to an oxygen tank and couldn't participate in the things that instilled life with meaning. And in the setting of all this, I visited him once in the rehab center, and he just looked bereft. And he said, "I'm just really scared." And I thought, you know, are you scared of what's coming? Are you scared of dying? He says, "I just hope that I'm going to be with Jesus. I hope I'm going to heaven and that God forgives me."
Huh.
He wasn't sure all of a sudden whether or not he was saved. Hmm. And I held his hand. I said, "David, you know, like, you placed your faith in Christ. You know you're going to be with him, right?" And he just said, "I'm just so sorry for the things I've done."
Yeah.
And so this was someone who knew the Bible, knew scripture, but the strains and the toils of illness momentarily clouded his vision of what he knew the truth to be.
Yeah.
And I think times in the hospital do this.
Absolutely. And I think I need for the listeners to come back a moment. So you had this wilderness experience, the bridge experience, even thinking of taking your own life and your husband's role in helping you out of that darkness.
Yeah.
Where did you reconnect with the Lord? What were you?
So for about a year of feeling like I was going through the motions and living really felt a lot like dying, like I had no connection to anything, I was working in the intensive care unit. And I was caring for this one gentleman who had suffered severe brain injury after having arrested. And he had CPR for about half an hour, which is a very long time. And it's very common in that setting that you have so little oxygen to your brain that you suffer injury afterwards. And his was severe enough that he was in a coma. And the neurologist didn't think that he would progress beyond maybe opening his eyes and tracking. And it was heartbreaking because his family was clinging to any sign that he would recover. And I'd go by and they'd say, "Dr. Katie, has anything changed?" And every time they'd ask me, I'd want to cry and say, "No, like, he's not going to get better." And in the setting of this, his wife one day, he loved cheesy 80s tunes.
Cheesy 80s.
80s tunes.
I might like some of those too.
Tiffany, Debbie Gibson, and they, and by report, not hair metal.
Okay, yeah.
And they used to sing them to each other, like when they were dating.
Even worse.
Yeah. And so one day I'm in the ICU and I hear one of these songs being belted from his room. And I run in and his wife all of a sudden is wearing a cross and she's hung another one about the size of an avocado over his bed.
Oh, wow.
And she said, "I woke up this morning and God told me he's going to be fine." And I looked at her and I, again, my heart was breaking because number one, I didn't believe in this God that she was talking about. And number two, everything pointed that he was not going to be fine.
Right.
And then later that day, his family calls me to the bedside. "Dr. Butler, Dr. Butler." I come in and they say, "He moved his toe when we asked." And I just, I'm so sorry. Like, this is probably a reflex. We see this all the time. And I yell in his ear and call his name and say, "Move your toe." He doesn't listen to me. His wife yells in his name and says, "Move your toe." And he does. Oh. And I say, "Okay, I hope it means something." But inwardly, of course, I think, no, it doesn't.
Right.
The next day, he opened his eyes and looked at her. The day after that, he started to move his hands to command. 2 weeks later, he was fully awake, fully communicative, pointing at his feeding tube, asking for filet mignon. So he had this recovery that was totally against all probability. And in medicine, we say, oh, it was an outlier, and we're just grateful that it happened, even if we don't understand it. But I couldn't ignore the fact that this had occurred in response to his wife's prayer. And I'm ashamed to say that even though that prayer had been in Jesus's name, although it alerted me to the truth that there's something beyond all our protocols and our science and what we can do, something more powerful than we could comprehend, I studied other religions. So I studied the Bhagavad Gita and I studied the Quran and I studied Buddhism, but found in every case that there was not an answer for sin, meaning that sin was something, even though I didn't have language for it, that I knew existed because of everything I'd seen.
Right.
That no matter what station of life you're in, eventually you'll come in through the double doors. and calamity and wickedness is just part of the human heart. And I thought, if it's up to us to save us from this, we're doomed.
Yeah.
And my husband entreated me, please read the Bible. Please just
Where
read the Gospels.
Where was he at spiritually?
He actually had also not been a believer until about the year before.
Wow.
And it was another instance of God working through a very dark time in his life to bring him to Christ. And so he had been for about a year attending church regularly and said, please just read the Gospels and read Romans. So I came home after work one day and normally should have gone to sleep because I was post-call. But I took his advice, and I had a Bible from high school that I'd never read. I pulled it off the shelf, wiped off the dust, cracked the spine, and I read the Gospels, and I read Romans. And when I got to Romans 5, I burst into tears. Mm. Not only because it showed us that through Christ, we can actually rejoice in our sufferings because our hope in Christ endures, but the line that did it for me was Romans 5:8, where it says, God shows his love for us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Meaning that Jesus came precisely because of the suffering that we're enduring and that he knows what it's like. He's endured the physical pain. He's endured the feeling of being cut off from God there on the cross. And God loves us so much that he put his son through this so that when he returns, all things will be made new. Mm. And he'll wipe away every tear from every eye, and the suffering and the death that we so hate now will be no more. Mm. And so it really was remarkable and just an example that God can work through our suffering to bring us to himself. And then no matter what we're going through, we can cleave to the hope and the promise that Jesus will make all things new.
So true. Mm.
This is Focus on the Family with Jim Daly. And our guest today is Katie Butler, and she's written a book capturing the heart and the emotion you're hearing right there. It's called Glimmers of Grace, A Doctor's Reflections on Faith, Suffering, and the Goodness of God. Get a copy of that book and find additional resources at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Katie, there's so much in what you're saying where people are living. Mm-hmm. You know, they kind of have come to the end of their rope when it comes to where are you, God? Mm-hmm. And the point is, that's okay. God can manage that. You know, sometimes we feel embarrassed that we're posturing ourselves that way, especially as believers, because we don't understand. Like your friend David, who did such a great job until his world was rocking, right? And then, Lord, have I not done it well enough for you? It's a fairly common believer problem that we have. Like, we're good as long as our health is with us and, you know, the family's doing well. But when things rock our boat, we tend or can go to doubt. Because, Lord, you said if we love you, we're going to have all these blessings and things. And I so love the fact how that scripture fit what you were thirsting for. That's how I feel.
Yes.
You know, it was exactly there that yet when we were sinners, Christ died for us because of our suffering. And it's the right antidote.
Yep.
It's boom, this is it. And this is what makes Christianity so powerful. Mm-hmm. It's God reaching down to us, not us trying to work our way into salvation, which is really those other religions.
Yeah.
It's just true.
Right.
I don't mean any disrespect to that, but you're not going to work your way into this. Mm-hmm. And God gives it to us as a gift. Mm-hmm. In the book, you also shared, Katie, that some of the mistakes you may have made at times in the hospital or errors, those kinds of, which are going to happen. Nobody's perfect.
Yeah.
I think doctors are probably the most prone to doing things correctly. That's why you're doctors.
No.
No, seriously, no. Though. But think of the training and the hours. And there may be some bad eggs, but I think generally as a profession, you guys are type A for a good reason. I want a type A doctor. Mm-hmm. The point in there, though, is that nothing's 100%. Mm-hmm. So, but this kind of haunted you with the Lord.
And oh, absolutely.
How did you reconcile that? That's really another great lesson in life.
I think one of the main points of conflict for many, many doctors actually is how to reconcile the mistakes that we make and the outcomes that go poorly despite our best efforts, or just the flat out things that we do wrong that seemed right at the time despite our training, because we all go through them. Every single one of us does. You know, and I recall very early the first time that I ever realized that I had made a mistake. I was in medical school and I was caring for a patient in the emergency room who was in a lot of pain and had this belly as tight as a drum. And I couldn't really tell what was going on and gave kind of a wishy-washy story to the attending and then went home. And it wasn't a year later that I learned about this and realized I'd missed something quite dangerous and that I'd risked and put my patient's life in danger inadvertently. And the guilt just tore at me. Hmm. And I said, I'm going to make absolutely sure that this never happens again and that I never make any mistakes. And I became compulsive, which I think is what many, many doctors do. And everything came second to work. And I would go home and I would wake up in the middle of the night and check my patient's labs to make sure everything was okay. And I'd be calling the resident on call to check in with them at 3 a.m. And I'd come in several hours before I was supposed to just because I was so scared of making another mistake. And it took such a toll that I wound up totaling my car on the way to work because I was so exhausted.
Oh, yeah.
And it was by God's grace that I was okay. Because we can't avoid making errors because of sin, because we're broken.
Yeah, how did the Lord settle your heart down, though, to say, hey,
It wasn't until I knew the grace of Christ.
Yeah.
It wasn't until I realized that I couldn't. And it's a verse that Paul tells us about. I think it's in 2 Corinthians, where, you know, he pleads for relief from his affliction, and God responds, my grace is sufficient for you. Just knowing that his grace is enough where I cannot fulfill the need that I feel I need to meet, and that we're forgiven through Christ and he separates our sins as far as us as the east from the west, really is the only consolation that I think you can have.
Yeah.
Because it is impossible to do everything right with our own hands.
Yeah. How have you learned that the Lord's faithfulness abounds even when you see the effect of sin in this world?
Oh my goodness, yeah. I think this is why I think remaining in the Word is so crucial, because when you're confronted with these things in real time, it can be very easy to fall into despair. And this is where I think the body of Christ is so critical to remind us, when we can't see it for ourselves, the truth of who God is. So what happens is, when you're in the Word and you realize that God provides and that he's merciful and that our circumstances don't change that, and when you cleave to what Jesus has done for us, then you start to see glimmers of his work even when you see calamity. But God still provides in beautiful ways that become more apparent when you realize that he's good and he's merciful.
Boy, when you say that, it's not what we were meant for.
No.
That lines up with scripture true.
Yep.
Also, because that
right.
We were created for everlasting life, right?
Right.
Okay, let me ask you a couple of questions that seems to be dominant in this area of suffering. Like, back to where you were years ago, if God is real, if God is there, how can he allow children to suffer? I think it's the number one question about people who doubt the existence of God. Because if God were real, and he's a good God, he would not allow a child to suffer, die of cancer, leukemia, whatever it might be.
Right.
What kind of answer would you give that person, the skeptic or the agnostic, kind of doubting?
Yeah, I think responding to these kinds of questions, it's really important not to have a response that's a platitude, to make light of it. Or I don't think you can tie it up neatly in a bow.
It's a serious question.
And I don't think we can know for sure why in any particular case something like this happens. We know that it's sin. We know that God can work through these kinds of events and the suffering for good, even if we don't see what it is. I think about John 11 a lot, where Jesus' friend Lazarus is dying, and his apostles say to him, you know, aren't you going to go and help him? And he stays, and he delays. And that's inconceivable to them. Why aren't you going to help Lazarus, right? And he arrives after Lazarus has already died, and Martha has the same response, Lord, if you'd only been here, he would have lived, right? And then what you see is that Jesus, in the presence of all these onlookers and mourners, raises Lazarus from the dead so that they all see that he's the Christ and place their faith in him.
Yeah.
And it doesn't create any easy answers, but it shows that oftentimes there's something beyond what we can see. And we can trust at least that God's still in the setting of suffering and the setting of heartbreak and sin and fallenness, which is something like that is. It's wrong. It's not what we were meant for. But he still can engage with it for good.
Well, again, I just feel that you are quite an eyewitness expert, given all of the sadness and all of the suffering that you've seen as a physician. Let's end here. For that person who's been through, severe trial, whatever it might be, but it's rocked them. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't know God, are you really there? Mm-hmm. It's shaken their faith. How would you encourage them today? The person listening, maybe again, dozens or hundreds, who knows?
Yeah. I would point, I think, to Hebrews 4, where it says we don't have a high priest who can't sympathize with us in our weakness. And to know that Jesus sees your suffering, and Jesus knows and has walked through that kind of agony, and he bore it for us. Mm-hmm. And I think looking to Revelation, the truth and the promise that he will return, and that he bore all this so that when he returns, he'll make all things new, and this will be no more, and that he will give us everlasting life and wipe away every tear from every eye.
Yeah. And speaking of not giving platitudes, the reality is God's ways are above our ways. Mm-hmm. We don't understand these things, the impact, the ripple. I wonder if heaven, at least in part, is going to be the connection of all those mm-hmm. dots, that we see the amazing symmetry that God creates about why things happen in this life and who, mm-hmm. someone you may not have even encountered, mm-hmm. knew something about something you did that changed their life. Obviously, the patience you engaged.
David, when he was in that dark place, God showed him who he was to bring him back. Mm-hmm. So he called me several weeks after this moment of doubt that he'd had. And he said, he'd had this one lucid moment after being very delirious and confused for a long time. And he said, Katie, I'm going to be okay. And he didn't mean physically.
Right.
He meant, I know where I'm going. Mm. And I said, what happened? And he said, I woke up. He's like, and God showed me the scene from Isaiah 6. And it's that scene where the hem, just the hem of God's robe fills the temple. And Isaiah responds with terror. Whoa, I'm a man of unclean lips. I'm undone. But David, knowing that he was saved in Christ, looked at that and said, God is so great, so much greater than any of us realizes. And he's so near. And that carried him through hospice in the end of his life, that comfort to know that God was so much bigger than anything he had ever conceived.
Yeah. And one thing for those of us who are generally healthy and doing okay is think about it. Mm-hmm. So then when we're not, we don't lose hope or faith in Christ, that it emboldens us for the next step. Like David, your friend. Yeah. This has been so good, Dr. Butler. I love it. And you're not in trouble.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Katie, thank you for expressing these things in this wonderful book, Glimmers of Grace. What a great resource for people who are doubting, people that are perhaps leaning into hopelessness. This is the exact resource that you need. And man, get in touch with us. Call us. We will get this book into your hands. If you can make a donation for any amount, we'll send it as our way of saying thank you. If you can't afford it, we're Christian ministry. We'll get it to you and trust others will cover the cost of that. The biggest point here is don't remain in that hopelessness. Find resources that will help you. You've heard from someone who was thinking of ending her life because of her despair. It doesn't get any more real than that. And I'm so glad that God's given you a testimony, mm-hmm. not just to help yourself, but to help so many others. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And do get in touch if we can be of help. We have caring Christian counselors here who can walk through your despair, or if you're up against some other significant life event or distress. Our number is 800, the letter A in the word family. You can also use that number to make a donation and to get a copy of Glimmers of Grace, A Doctor's Reflections on Faith, Suffering, and the Goodness of God. That's the book that Katie has written, and as Jim said, we'll send that out to you when you make a donation of any amount today to Focus on the Family. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.